¿Se acuerdan de esto?
Non abbiate paura. Aprite, anzi, spalancate le porte a Cristo. Non abbiate paura.
Tenía la fuerza de un gigante, dijo Benedicto XVI. Fuerza que le venía de Dios, para darnos ejemplo en primera persona de no tener miedo. En una palabra, decía Benedicto, San Juan Pablo II ayudó a no tener miedo de la verdad. Solamente buscando la verdad es como pudo dar ejemplo de abrir a Cristo la sociedad, la cultura, los sistemas políticos y económicos, haciendo lo que parecía prácticamente imposible. ¿Cómo pudo hacerlo? Porque conocía la realidad. Solamente quien conoce la realidad de las cosas puede actuar bien, con libertad y sin miedo. A esto nos referimos cuando decimos que Él nos dio ejemplo de morder la realidad. Es decir, darnos cuenta de lo que está pasando para así evangelizar adecuadamente. ¿Saben por qué San Juan Pablo II conocía tan bien la realidad? Porque conocía la filosofía de Santo Tomás de Aquino, la metafísica del ser, que como dice San Pablo VI, es la metafísica natural del entendimiento humano y por tanto llega a conocer la realidad. Mediante el conocimiento de la realidad del ser, podemos remontarnos a la máxima realidad, el ser divino trascendente, Dios. Por eso nosotros estudiamos a Santo Tomás de Aquino, porque solamente podremos evangelizar adecuadamente si partimos del conocimiento de la realidad. El padre Nathaniel Dreyer, misionero en Italia, en la abadía de Fossanova, nos cuenta la importancia de la doctrina de Santo Tomás y de las obras del padre Cornelio Fabro para morder la realidad.
For me, when we talk about the grace of Thomism as a non-negotiable element of our charism, really for me, on the one hand, this means simply being obedient to the Church, because from the time of Aquinas up until today, the Church has always maintained the primacy and preeminence of the angelic doctrine. For instance, Pope St. Paul VI says in no uncertain terms that the Church officially approves the teaching of the angelic doctrine. And she uses it as an instrument superbly adapted to her purposes. He goes so far to say that the Church casts the mantle of her own magisterial authority over Aquinas. And in that same train of thought, Pope Innocent VI said that those who hold to the teachings of Aquinas are never found swerving from the path of truth. And the one who dares to assail it will always be suspected of error. So what more could we want? This is what the Church upholds and tells us is a good thing to follow. Now, on the other hand, though, this is key to our charism, the evangelization of the culture. And that's because evangelization means simply to propose the truth that saves. And that truth is a person, it's Jesus Christ. And so evangelization means to lead others to an encounter with Christ and His gospel. Now that proposal, we know from the Church's teachings, has to respect the intellect and the freedom of the people that we're evangelizing. And it's Aquinas who gives us the perfect model for that. Because to follow Aquinas' teachings means to know that grace doesn't destroy nature. It doesn't tear it down, but rather builds it up and brings it to fulfillment. To follow Aquinas means to be submissive to the Church's teachings, to seek and to find the fullness of truth. But perhaps more importantly, and maybe even more fundamentally, it means to have the right way of looking at the world and the universe around us. Pope Pius XI made an interesting comment when he says that in Thomism, we have what we might call a natural gospel. It's a very solid basis and framework for any sort of whole doctrinal structure that we want to build up. And he says this is because it's characteristic of Thomism to be concerned first and foremost with the objective order. And by that he means with reality. And he goes on to say that this concern with reality, with what's real, is what gives Thomism its superiority and power. And because this doesn't change, this reality, It means that the way that Thomas sees the world and sees the truth doesn't change either. It's perennially valid. And that's why we study Aquinas. And we study him with the help of those scholars who have appreciated his thought and tried to delve even more deeply into it. And the great example of this for us is Father Cornelio Fabro. Because like Aquinas, he didn't just remain statically enclosed in what he read, but rather he engaged thought. He engaged modern thinkers, found their errors, discovered the root of modern atheism, and tried to engage modern man in a dialogue that leads to his salvation. He discovered the authentic notion of freedom and studied, perhaps more profoundly than anyone else, the teachings of Soren Kierkegaard. Like Aquinas, Fabro was unrelenting in his fidelity to the Church. And it's for all these reasons that we take him as a model, not only as philosopher and theologian, but also as a religious and a priest.
Los siguientes elementos esenciales que marcan nuestro carisma son lo que llamamos las misiones emblemáticas y el tener creatividad apostólica. El padre Pedro López es superior de nuestra misión en Tayikistán. Él nos contará cómo fue que recibimos el encargo del mismo San Juan Pablo II para ir a misionar a este país de mayoría musulmana.